أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا وفقنا وفعلا في الدين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله في الأولين صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله في الآخرين صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وعلى أعلى إليه. We'll talk about the station of Dhikr. Dhikr came in the Quran, obviously, as you know, where Allah Ta'ala said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Mention me or remember me, I'll remember you in a way suitable to Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Lakin, the ulama of Tazkiya, they take especially the maqam of dhikr or the station of dhikr from the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said fi surah al-Kahf, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wadhkur rabbaka idha nasit. Wadhkur rabbaka idha nasit, which means remember your Lord whenever you forget. Or mention your Lord when you forget. Nasit, meaning to forget. Wadhkur Rabbak, remember your Lord, idha nasit. Taban, to the masters of Tazkiya, may Allah be pleased with them, they look at this from an ishara point of view. Yani this ayah, they look at it from an ishara. What do you mean from an ishara? Yani when Allah says, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ, and be in the dhikr of your Lord when you forget, what do you mean you forget? When you forget other than Him. First level. And remember your Lord, إِذَا نَسِيتْ, إِذَا نَسِيتَ غَيْرَهُ, if you forget other than Him. لا وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ, and be in the dhikr of your Lord if you forget yourself in your dhikr. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ, إِذَا نَسِيتَ, if you forget your dhikr because of His dhikr. Then, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ, if you forget everything but His dhikr of you. So therefore, the actual ishara or sign in إِذَا نَسِيتْ, or if you forget, to the ulama of Tazkiya, has multiple levels. All right. Taban, let's go with the first one and say, when they mention وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ, mention your Lord if you forget or whenever you forget. And we mentioned that whenever you forget means first, on the first level, whenever you forget other than Him. The ulama of Tazkiya or Suluk, they call this غَيْر. And that's a word you should be familiar with if you like the science of Tazkiya. غَيْر or siwa, both. Siwa in the Arabic language means other than. غَيْر in the Arabic language also means other than. مَا فِي قَلْبِي غَيْرُ اللَّهِ, right, they say? For example, some people in their adhkar, which means there's nothing in my other than Allah. غَيْر means other. Lakin, the ulama of Tazkiya used that as a word on its own. Linguistically, it's not. But they say you cannot pay attention to the ghayr like this. So they make, they identify the ghayr, or the siwa. And what they mean by the ghayr or the siwa, other than Allah Rabbul Alameen. Whatever it is, it's ghayr. Ghayrullah, siwa Allah, so that's ghayr. So therefore, the first ishaa in the ayah, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتَ غَيْرَهُ. If you forget other than him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does that mean? It means when you are making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are not making dhikr of him with your tongue and you are in remembrance of other than him. That means you still are in remembrance of the ghayr. You are not in the dhikr of him, even if your tongue is busy with his dhikr. So what that means is you are aware that you are making dhikr, and you are making dhikr وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ of Allah إِذَا نَسِيد. The real dhikr of Allah is when you forget who other than him. If you don't forget other than him, you're not really realizing the ayah. You're not following the ayah, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتَ, and mention your Lord when you forget. Because you're not really forgetting the siwa or the ghayr. You are present in the siwa and the ghayr while you're pretending to do dhikr of him, and therefore your dhikr is not there. So therefore the first is, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتَ. You remember your Lord, you are in the dhikr really, إِذَا نَسِيتَ, if you forget the ghayr or the siwa. So you are actually forgetting the ghayr, you are forgetting the siwa, you are sidelining them. That's the first level, and that's important. Yeah. These are the darajat of dhikr, and they're important for the dhakir. The second thing I mentioned here is, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. Now you've already done the first. You're good. Like now, let's see. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. And remember or be in the dhikr of your Lord if you forget yourself in your dhikr. Not if you forget the siwa or the ghayr. This is already a plea. You've already done that. Like now, the dhikr above that, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. If you really forget yourself in the dhikr, that is when you actually are doing dhikr. You lose yourself in the dhikr of your Lord. Dhikr. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. نَسِيتَ نَفْسَكَ فِي ذِكْرِكَ. You forgot yourself in your dhikr. Yani, what do you mean you forget yourself in your dhikr? You sit and you do 100 times astaghfirullah, or 100 times la ilaha illallah, or 100 times Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala, and you're bored and you're looking at the watch, or your mind is already off the dhikr. Number one, you didn't even remember him. You did not do the first level of dhikr, let alone the second level of dhikr. You did not mention him, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ. If you forget other than him, the siwa or the ghayr, let alone that you forgot yourself in your dhikr. Because with the second one, with the first one, you're forgetting him, you're forgetting everything but him. So there's you, there's the dhikr, there's him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You, dhikr, and him, nothing else. With the second degree, you are forgetting yourself in the dhikr, your own dhikr of him. So there is your dhikr and him. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتَ نَفْسَكَ فِي ذِكْرِكَ. Then, واذكر ربك اذا نسيت اذا نسيت ذكرك في ذكره, which means you be in the dhikr of your Lord when you forget your dhikr in his dhikr. So not only that, now you remember your dhikr of him. You remember him. You don't remember your dhikr. You remember him. His dhikr. Allah, 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 Allah. And then وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. On the higher level, be in the dhikr of your Lord if you forget. It means if you forget everything else, including your dhikr of him, because of his dhikr of you. Because he told you, فَذْكُرُونِي أذكركم. Mention me or remember me, I'll remember you. All the first four phases, you're remembering the first half, فَذْكُرُونِي, to actually arrive at actual you mention me, until you go to the last one, where you forget everything, yourself and your own dhikr, and witnessing that you're doing dhikr and witnessing his dhikr, to witness him doing dhikr of you in a way that's suitable to him, and we don't know what that is. So this is the key to dhikr in reality. Right? This is the key to dhikr. First, and therefore you see how the ayah, one ayah, you can take it with ishara on all these four different levels. And the ayah is only four words, and it has four levels, ishara wise. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. Be in the dhikr of your Lord, إِذَا, if, نَسِيتْ, if you forgot, or if you forget, if you forget everything else, الغير, right? وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ, if you forget yourself now, in his dhikr, you witness his dhikr, and you witness that his name in your dhikr of him. And then, being in the dhikr of your Lord, if you forget your dhikr of him by his name that you're mentioning, and then, if you forget everything about you and your dhikr of him, and even you're mentioning his name because of the remembrance or of his dhikr of you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's important. That's important. And that's why in the fourth stage, when you move from فَذْكُرُونِي to the أَذْكُرْكُمْ, when you, once you move from to أَذْكُرْكُمْ, that's what they say, يعني the ulama of Suluk, they talk about the collection of your heart and yourself and everything unto Allah Rabbul Alamin. As if you were still lost before and you're collecting yourself. You collect your heart here, you collect this here, you detach, you attach, right? As we've talked about from the beginning. So you drop all these things, you attach yourself to things until you get to فَذْكُرُونِي. Once you master فَذْكُرُونِي, you'll move to فَذْكُرْكُمْ. And at that time, why do the ulama of Tazkiya and Suluk and Ihsan don't say أَذْكُرْكُمْ, what do you mean? Nobody knows. In that sense, what do you mean nobody knows? No, people know. But it's indescribable in words. Because that's when all the isharat and all the ibarat and all the words and all the signs cannot capture whatever it is. It's not captured. It cannot be captured. It cannot be described. Hence, you leave it. So that's in general the levels of dhikr and the keys really to dhikr. Without that, your dhikr is still sort of everywhere. In general, when we talk about dhikr, when Allah says, فَذْكُرُونِ يَذْكُرُكُمْ or وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيْتَ, really the dhikr is exactly opposite of ghafla. That's what the definition of dhikr. Sometimes you say, what's the definition of dhikr? Obviously, anyone who says dhikr, yani reciting things or that, that's not really the actual meaning. Al-dhikru is ridding yourself of ghafla. That's what dhikr is. Ghafla means what? Heedlessness. Absenteeism. Ghafil. That's what dhikr is. Doesn't matter what you do. If there is no ridding yourself of heedlessness or absenteeism from Allah, it's not dhikr. So therefore, important is to define what dhikr is. All right, and therefore, we talk always again about three levels. The first level, after this long introduction in a sense, what the ulama of suluk call dhikrun zahir, or apparent dhikr, obvious dhikr, such as what? Praise, dua, or a dhikr of a dhikr that is designed to, or is aims at increasing the presence or the closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such as what? Yeah, for example, you say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu akbar, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim, Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala. So all these things, hada dhikr zahir, it's apparent. So this is, for example, you're praising Allah Ta'ala. This is praise of Allah Ta'ala. Or dhikr also zahir is dua. For example, when you make dua, رَبَّنَا لَا تُعَاخِذْنَا إِنْ نَسِيْنَا وَأَخْطَأْنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ. Dua, you're making dua, that's dhikr as well. So your dhikr is either praise of Allah, Alhamdulillah, Subhanallah, La ilaha illallah, etc. Or it is dua, like this ayah that I brought you, or other dua, that's also a form of dhikr. And that's for the beginner, obviously. Again, still, and the advanced does not let that either. Or the dhikr is such as, which is used to, other than that, but it's used to increase the closeness to Allah Ta'ala in the heart, for the heart that is in absenteeism or in ghafla or heedlessness. Such as, Allah is with me, Allahu ma'i, Allahu shahidi, Allahu nadiri. Allah is with me, Allahu ma'i, Allahu shahidi, Allah is witnessing me, Allahu nadiri, Allah is observing me or looking at me. Why are these things like this? Because this, you're trying to what? You're trying to inject forcefully these meanings in your heart so it can bring you closer to observing that you're being observed. Now intellectually you realize that you're being observed. You understand and believe that Allah sees you. Everybody understands that. But the point is not intellectual, right? We talked about that today, right? Sacrifice is not going buying a lamb and sacrificing. Excuse me, anybody can do that. That's not the lesson that we learned in the Ayyullah from Ibrahim alayhi salam. Anybody can do this. Sacrifices, what have you really sacrificed? Adha, from udhiya, yani udhiya means sacrifice. That's what the name of the whole word means. You can't take it on taking this thing and put it on the poor animal. Once you sacrifice like Ibrahim and Ismail, then maybe Allah gives you that and that replaces you with that. But anyway, what have you sacrificed? What's your Ismail? So these things is obviously a dhikr that has to do with forcefully injecting so you can actually be in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, realize that Allah is observing you, and also what to have the adab with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani al-ghafil, people of ghafla have no adab with Allah in general. How can you observe your etiquette with Allah? Adab yani etiquette. How can you observe etiquette with Allah if you are absent from Allah ta'ala entirely anyway? So, and these kinds of adhkar obviously also protect you from ghafla. And that's why it's allegedly that Sahal bin Abdullah Tustari, one of the scholars of the Salaf, used to repeat these things, Allahu nadhiri, Allahu ma'i, Allahu shahidi, Allah is with me, Allah is witnessing me, Allah is seeing me, etc. All these things so they can, that he can force that in himself. And this way, he forcefully gets out of heedlessness or ghafla and stays away from shaitan. And also, if the heart is present, then you also may come under the circle or in the circle of Allah's special care. And if you get into, and that's what the ulama of tasawwuf and tazkiya and suluk call ri'aya. Ri'aya. Ri'aya really means care. It means care. Lakin, if you have ri'aya from Allah, if Allah gives you His ri'aya, and if Allah takes care of you, then you don't have to. Just like Allah said to Musa alayhi salam, or told the mother, وَلْتُصْنَعَ عَلَىٰ عَيْنِي, you shall grow up under my direct care. Throw him in the well, throw him in the river, throw him in the river, so what? Nothing will happen. Even if you throw him in million rivers, nothing's going to happen to him. Why? Because Allah already told us that what? You are under my direct care, the meaning of the ayah. Now, and therefore, one of the poets mentioned, وَيَعْنِي the poets of Suluk and the ulama of Tazkiyah, he says, وَإِذَا الْعِنَايَةُ لَاحَظَتْكَ عُيُونُهَا نَمْ فَالْحَوَادِثُ كُلُّهُنَّ. If the ri'aya or the special care of Allah is with you, nam, sleep. Sleep. Anything that happens is safety. فَالْحَوَادِثْ كُلُّهُنَّ أَمَانٌ. Everything that will happen is safe. It doesn't matter if qiyamah and zalzalah happens, you're safe. No, Allah is with you and the care of Allah. You don't have to worry about it. That's important. That's the reason, yani that's what the first degree of dhikr gets you to accomplish in a sense. A dhikr of dhahir. This dhikr is, you're doing it with your tongue, you're doing it, etc. You're doing istighfar, you're doing salawat ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You're doing this. And that's why, yani the sunnah of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that he used to do 70 times istighfar a day. Ufi riwayah 100 times as well, another narration. Now remember, the Arabs don't say 70 times meaning 69 plus 1 or 71 minus 1. They use that for kathra. Kathra. To mean a lot. 70 to the Arabs back then doesn't mean necessarily 69 plus 1. It means a lot. Just like when you say 99, it means a lot. Now, when you say, I told you 100 times, you don't necessarily, a lot, that's what they also mean. But then it means more than just that. That's the first. The second dhikr is what they call a dhikrul khafi, or the concealed dhikr. Now, I'm not trying to distinguish between the dhikr of the heart and the dhikr of the tongue, by the way. Remember, there's a weak hadith, and some Sufis also use it. And they say that allegedly the Prophet ﷺ said, خَيْرُ الذِّكْرِ الْخَفِيِّ. وَهَذَا حَدِيثٌ لَكِنَّهُ ضَعِيفٌ. Very weak. So I don't like to depend on these things. Right? This means the best of dhikr is that which is khafi. And they mean the dhikr of the heart. But we've already talked about that before. By saying what? By the definition of dhikr. What's dhikr? Ridding of ghafla. Ghafla is not just on the tongue. Ghafla is where? You're conscious. The heart. So by definition, if you don't have a dhikr of the heart, you're not in dhikr anyway. You haven't even started. We understand each other. That's what dhikr. That's what Allah says, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. If you're in ghafla, come back to dhikr. Nasit means you forgot. Forgot means what? Heedlessness, absenteeism. So as if the ayah is defining dhikr for you. Notice we saw the kaf. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. If you forget, mention your Lord. Come back. So, I'm not talking about that here by saying khafi in a sense, concealed, meaning the heart. No, the dhikr aslan in the heart. The aslan of the dhikr is in the heart, not on the tongue. Now, it doesn't mean you don't do dhikr of the tongue, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do dhikr of the tongue. But the stemming of the dhikr of the tongue is in the heart. That's where the origin of that dhikr is. So, when we talk about al-dhikr al-jali, or we talk about the dhikr al-zahir, or al-jali, the apparent or the obvious dhikr, I am not saying that you're just saying subhanallah on your tongue and that's it. No. You're saying subhanallah in your heart, and your tongue is translating what your heart is feeling and experiencing. And you're saying la ilaha illallah with your heart, not just with your tongue, from the get-go. Because otherwise you're not moving. Okay, you're gonna ask a question. Well, I mean, isn't it better that I do a dhikr of the tongue and ghafla, absenteeism of the heart, rather than nothing? Yeah, okay, it's better than nothing. So is it better to, eat dead meat or riba and steal? Yeah, sure, one is better than two vices. I mean, one is better than two, sure, if you're asking me. But that's not the point. So we understand each other. The point of dhikr starts immediately. When we say jali, it means, or zahir, it means it's obvious, and that obvious dhikr is to get you from the state of ghafla. And that cannot happen without the heart being involved whatsoever. Whether you sit and say in your heart, subhanAllah, without saying anything, subhanAllah, subhanAllah, or you actually utter, subhanAllah, 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 whichever. The second one is the jali, afwan al-khafi, al-dhikr al-khafi, or the concealed dhikr. And this dhikr is not just dua or thana or praise or making dua. It is actually ridding yourself from boredom and weakness and staying with witnessing what we call shuhud. Shuhud means to witness. وَشَاهِدًا وَمَشْهُودٌ. There's a witness and there's the witnessed. شَاهِد is witness. مَشْهُود is the witnessed. So the reason for the concealed, we'll talk about that, what that means, is number one, getting yourself from what? Ridding yourself from boredom and weakness. What does that mean? Boredom and weakness is obviously from ghafla and forgetfulness, or hijab, veil. Yani, you move now beyond the first level where you actually have presence. You make dhikr of Allah with your heart. And you kick off heedlessness or ghafla, just like you turn off the light, you turn on the light in your room. You come at night, you turn the light on, there's light. Before there was darkness. So you got there. But now, you got there, it's one thing to have Mahbub knows that well, one thing to have a loading dose, and one thing is to have a maintenance dose. When you put a patient on medication, there's first a loading dose. And that dose has to be usually higher because I need to get him to life. I need to get him to an effective state. I need to get that blood, that drug in the blood at a certain level. So usually the loading dose is high. Then I get him on a maintenance dose. The loading is the apparent, obviously. The maintenance is what? Is how do you stay in presence? Because shaitan will come to you. Yourself will come to you. Shaitan will be active 24 hours on 25 different screens coming to your mind while you're doing dhikr. Every possible thing that you can think of will come, and other things that you don't think of will come as well. I mean, you know, you're going in the right path. Shaitan is on alert. It's red, it's not even orange anymore. Let me get you out of this before you go on. And therefore, the first disease that happens to the seeker of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after they sort of realize how do they move from heedlessness to presence or to dhikr yani, is boredom and weakness. Weakness in that dhikr. You know, they get bored quickly or they feel weak quickly. They can't, you know, we call that loss of appetite. General malaise. Tired. That's a problem. That's a sign of disease, obviously, in the heart, and surely that requires more structuring of the first degree of dhikr, which means bringing yourself again from state of ghafla to state of dhikr through increasing your adhkar and la ilaha illallah and trying to diversify. I always say, dhikr for the beginners and others as well, everybody, ought to be like a bouquet of flowers. Right? Diversify. Some Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, some A'udhu Billahi min ash-Shaytan ar-Rajim, some La ilaha illallah, some Astaghfirullah, some Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa Ali, some Alhamdulillah. It's like when you go and you make a bouquet of flowers. Make a bouquet of flowers of dhikr. Because everyone has a different taste. Try to expose yourself to that spiritual impact that every kind of dhikr will give you. So you taste as well. Surely there's, you know, those who have specific regimen of dhikr. Those people who are yani, professional seekers. Or they actually supposedly official seekers, and they enroll in a school of seeking per se, and they are assigned specific regimens. That's your specific line, but also diversify. Diversification is good. Add at will. Alright, so the concealed dhikr is focusing more on the heart and what the heart is exposed to, rather than generally the praise and the dua and the forceful injection of dhikr. What that means is that's why we call it concealed, or the scholars call it concealed sometimes, or the non-apparent dhikr. They want you to focus basically on the state of your heart while doing dhikr sincerely and selflessly. Not on the state of how many times you say that. Sure, you gotta keep that in the back of your mind. But how is your heart with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And is your heart reacting to anything? Are you getting anything back from the dhikr? Do you have any, are you getting any illuminations? Any even sparks back? Any sukoon and sakina and tranquility? Any spiritual breeze that are you getting? Expose yourself, and you're all checking your heart and waiting to see how your heart is exposing to that. Surely it requires a lot of veil removal, so that first phase has to be strong enough for the seeker to be in the middle level. And surely, once you have that, once you sort of get used to having every now and then taste the sweetness of the dhikr. Hadith al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sahih hadith, you all know. ذَاقَ طَعْمَ الْإِيمَانِ, right? You will taste the sweetness of Iman. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used the word ذَاقَ. ذَاقَ means from ذَوْق. From what? ذَوْق. ذَوْق means what? Taste. ذَوْق. Taste. As if you taste food. Literally, in that sense. ذَوْق. Right? That's what the whole path of Tazkiya is what? Is mahabbatun wa dhawqun wa shawq. The people of Allah, Their path is simple. Dhawq wa shawq, that comes from muhabba. So muhabba is their key, and their muhabba are to give them dhawq and shawq. Once they have muhabba, that generates, a true muhabba generates dhawq and shawq. Shawq means what? Yearning for, wanting, desiring, shawq. The people of muhabba, if the muhabba is true, if the muhabba is a claim, it's not going to give you anything. A claim will give you no dhawq and no shawq. But if the muhabba, if the love is true, your claim of love is even partially true, it will at least give you, it will yield at least partial, though partial taste of that muhabba, and partial shawq, which is yearning, desire for more. If you have something good, you want to desire more. But that's only if there's genuine muhabba. What is the next stage from that? Our mashayikh said, rifqun wa sidqun wa ishq. So first you start with muhabba based, that generates dhawq and shawq, which leads you to what? Rifq wa sidq wa ishq. Rifq means what? Hadith Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha. Rifq means kindness, care. Wasidq means truthfulness. Wa'ishq means ishq. Now, so, ridding yourself of, once you have these spiritual breezes and spiritual sparks and the taste, some dhawq, some taste, some, and generate some show, it changes into some riff, some sid. That should rid you from weakness in the dhikr or of the dhikr. That should rid you from boredom in the dhikr or of the dhikr. It's still a work that you have to do. And also for the middle seeker, obviously, it's not only ridding them from the boredom, but also remaining with shuhud, which means what? Remaining on, what are you witnessing? What are you doing dhikr of? Yourself? Are you making dhikr of yourself? Or are you observing that you are actually making dhikr? Or are you observing the remembered? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where is your heart in the dhikr? With yourself? With your dhikr, or with the madhkur, the one you're mentioning? With the shahid, or with the mashhur? With the talib, or with the matloob? Yani with the seeker, or the sought after? With whom? That's important. For the people, obviously, is there, obviously, to remain, and that they have to struggle to remain with their shuhud. They're witnessing when they say La ilaha illallah. They ought to keep their heart witnessing that they are making dhikr of Allah. And it's not that they're making dhikr but with Allah. La ilaha illallah. No raziq but Allah. No qadir but Allah. No shafi but Allah. No mu'afi but Allah. Etc. All these sifat. And also, many of the ulama of suluk, they mention even for the middle seeker, is not simply also struggling to be with the witnessed rather than witnessing what's happening, or being with the witness rather than with the witnessed. They say also to remain with the, or to hold on to that tranquility that you have. And they sometimes, and I use the word musamara. And musamara in the Arabic language, you know, if you have a very dear friend, and that's not to make Allah similar to the creation, wa iyadu billah, anything. But if you have a friend that you really love and you really like, whatever you love or like, I guess you love, or you really, really like, let's say, even if you don't like, go to the extent of love, let's say. And you want to talk to that friend, and you stay you know, at night talking to that friend about everything. That's called in the Arabic language samar. And that's where the word samira, for example, comes from for a female, or samir for a male. You may have heard that name as well. Just like the word shadi or shadiya. Shadi means singer. Shadiya means the female singer. You know, people like these names. Alhamdulillah. Whatever name you like, I'm happy with you as long as you like it. Lakin samir and samar, that comes from someone who spends the night with their friend, and it's a conversation that you just, when you sleep, you're just sleeping because you're tired, not because you have finished. Huh? That's called samar. And the ulama of suluk radiallahu ta'ala anhum or mashayikh have taught us, may Allah be pleased with them and grant their souls the highest level in Jannat al-Firdaus with the Anbiya and the Shuhada and the Siddiqeen and the Salihin, they said one ought to hold on to the samar with Allah in a way that's suitable to him. Ajib. When, obviously, when they say that, what do they mean? There has to be dhikr, because you can't have samar with someone that is absent. There has to be dhikr and presence. And you are making dhikr with Allah. وَهَذَا مَقَامٌ. And this actually overlaps with other maqam. Ahlul Tazkiya, Ahlullah, they call it maqam al-bast. This is the maqam of bast. Bast being like this, qabd being like this. We, amongst the name of Allah, is al-basit. And bust is like this, when you do bust of the hand, is like opening it up. And as if it's an indication that you are open with Allah. You are used, you love that talk. You love that munajah, that you're talking to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? That you are speaking to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you are reading His Quran, that His Quran that you're reading is talking to you. Etc., that dua, etc., etc., etc. And usually the samar happens only at night. Yani even if you see good friends and all these things, you want to speak to them, so look, I have to finish everything I have to do. After Maghrib, we'll meet and we'll sit, we'll have the whole night, we'll talk. Even until today, samar is as if it's always at night. We'll have some chai, we'll sit and talk. Maybe. When we say samar, we say that in a way applicable to the Creator Jalla Jalaluhu. We mean absolutely no likening of Allah Ta'ala to His creation in any way. So that's what the middle seeker ought to be in focus on in dhikr. Number one, on ridding themselves from weakness and debilitation. Notice Allah talks about the munafiqeen as well. لَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. They make dhikr, but they make qaleela, little dhikr. So you gotta move from that. Number two, you gotta what? Struggle to keep remaining with the witness. Not witness what you're doing, witness the witness. Or witness the action of the witness. Well, you wouldn't be a witness if you're not witnessing, to start with. From the beginning, you're not a witness, really. But remaining with the witnessed. As Allah says, وَشَاهِدًا وَمَشْهُودٌ. In that hadra, I mean, in that presence, hadra means presence, in that presence, you begin with shahid and mashhud. A witness and a witnessed. That's how you begin. But how do you end? كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانٌ. As Allah says, everything in that at that time will vanish. وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. Only your Lord remains. As the ayah says. at the beginning, طبعا خير. هذا in a way that's suitable to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the advanced, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among them in this maqam of dhikr and how they understand it. طبعا this is the real dhikr. And that's why many of the ulama of suluk in the old days, 1,000 years ago or so, they called it هذا ذكر حقيقي. The real dhikr. As if the other stations of dhikr for the beginners in the middle, that's not really dhikr, we're trying to get there, but it's not really dhikr. And they said, dhikr haqiqi, this is the dhikr. Huh? وَالذِكْرُ الْحَقِيقِ, they said the real dhikr is moving from this ayah. Ayah has two words, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Moving from فَذْكُرُونِي to أَذْكُرْكُمْ. From make dhikr of me, or be in my dhikr, I will be in yours. So they're moving from still them making dhikr to observing what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's dhikr of them. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taba'an, what that means obviously is that you witness that. What does that mean, yani Allah makes dhikr of you? It means that Allah specifies you to be amongst those who are close to Him. Remember we talked about the care of Allah, ri'aya, the special care of Allah. Allah, dhikr of you means that you witness that He took you from where you are and put you in a circle of His close awliya. He took you from where you are and He put you and illuminated you and put you amongst those who are Ahlul Qurb, the people of closeness to Him. Ahlullah, the people of Allah. Ahlul Mahabba, the people of Mahabba. He puts you on different level based on your altitude, aptitude, and attitude. Always say, right? That's how it works. Right? It's always like that. Well, طبعاً, there are people whom Allah willed for them eternally to be granted that. Fadl. Sometimes Allah gives His bounties without any questions. And for reasons we don't know and can't fathom anyway. Someone you don't think is worthy of anything, Allah takes that person and puts them there. Good. And others, they have to struggle and work hard to rid themselves of all their shayateen. That's the majority. So therefore, when yani meaning, when this for the advanced people, they witness that Allah is in dhikr of them, it means what? Allah is in dhikr of you. Yani Allah remembers you. Is Allah subject to forgetting you to start with? Is Allah subject to forgetting anyway? Anyone who says Allah is subject to forgetting is kafir, is not Muslim to start with. Huh? وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَّ, Allah says. Your Lord is not subject to forgetting. What do you mean dhikr to Allah? After heedlessness, وَلَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, that's kufr. After absenteeism, وَلَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, that's kufr. What do you mean then Allah makes dhikr of you? Allah puts you with His special slaves under a special care. وَلِتُصْنَعَ عَلَىٰ عَيْنِ, you'll be raised under my direct care, like He told Musa. وَأَلْقَيْتُ عَلَيْكَ مَحَبَّةً مِنِّي, and like He told Musa, I have enveloped you with my love. You then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens for you that enveloping itself, that you are enveloped in His love subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every mu'min is enveloped like that, but the people of Ahlullah, the awliya of Allah, are special. It's a much higher level, obviously. Now, and also there are maqams after that. Yani that maqam that you witness, what is it that you witness that Allah is in your dhikr? Yani أذكركم, أذكروني أذكركم, what does that really entail? This is limitless. And many of the people of Ahlullah, when they and the awliya, when they go from one maqam to other maqam, you think,
they look at the maqams they were 10 years ago, they say, we thought we got there. We didn't know anything then. And moving, I had the maqamat now, there's no end to them, really. There's no end to them, only Allah knows what's the end to them. And obviously the highest maqam is al-maqam al-Muhammadi. على صاحبه أفضل الصلاة والسلام مقام سيد الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين وسيد الأولياء صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وسلم. يعني all the masters of the أولياء are on the feet of سيدنا رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله. ف that's basically that مقام. Surely what that مقام entails, that you moved from فذكروني to where? أذكركم, which means what? You no longer witness فذكروني, in the sense you no longer witness your dhikr of him. Not only you're making dhikr of him, I should not say making, really. More proper, yani from a theological point of view, is to say in dhikr of him rather than making dhikr of him. Making dhikr doesn't make it, I don't understand. In his dhikr, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his remembrance. In his dhikr means you are in his dhikr, but you're absent from your dhikr of him, for you are present in his dhikr of you. And that's what they call istighraq. Istighraq is, you know, when someone drowns, وَلْيَعْذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ اللَّهِ help us. And once that minute, that water covers their head. That's called istighraq in a sense. Totally submerged. There's nothing left. You can't see anything anymore. And that's totally submerged in witnessing of him in your dhikr, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this rank comforts the nafs from seeing itself, finally. Nafs is busy and still seeking. Once that nafs gets there, and nafs has that raha now, it reaches that comfort from seeing itself and gets to the pleasure of witnessing its creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. For at this level, Ahlullah, they view it's a forgery or a lie to be witnessing your dhikr of him. They call that iftira. Iftira means a forgery, a lie. You're making things up. What do you mean I'm making things up? Am I not making dhikr of him? They say, no, not really. Why? They're at that fadhkurkum. What do they see? They don't see fadhkuruni. Things are coming to you from you to him. Adhkurkum. No. They see things coming from him to you and then taking you back to him. So they don't see your fadhkuruni is really yours to start with. That's why if you ascribe it or attribute it to yourself, that I am making that dhikr, you are lying, and hence you don't deserve to be in that presence on the other side. That presence does not accept liars. Why? They say, because who is the one who facilitated for you to do dhikr of him or to be in his dhikr? Who taught you how to be in his dhikr? Who empowered you to be in his dhikr? Who sent you books to teach you how to be in his dhikr? Who sent you messengers to teach you how to be in his dhikr? So it all came from him, and then even when you became in his dhikr, was by his will for you to be in his dhikr. So it's all from him to him, and it's his bounty that's grabbing you all the way to the other side. It's not really you. So if you attribute that to yourself to say that you are doing dhikr or you are dhakir, you're lying in that sense, they fear. And that presence of Allah is holy, muqaddas. A liar is not admissible there. And that's why they talk about this is the real dhikr. So what does that mean, the real dhikr? Yani that you are in the dhikr, that he is in your dhikr. So you are witnessing his bounties upon you. You see what your dhikr? That's why now when you say Alhamdulillah, it has a different flavor. And you're witnessing where it came from, and I don't, you have, then you realize you have to say Alhamdulillah for saying Alhamdulillah. You see what I'm trying to say? I mean, you know, Ya Allah, praise be to you that you allowed me to praise you. Huh? The whole point that, the whole point of suluk and ihsan and tazkiya is that polishing of that nafs. If you don't polish that nafs, nafs ra'ina, ra'ina means ruthless. If you don't polish it, it's going to drive you crazy. And it's never going to get you to the right place. And ilm obviously disciplines the nafs, but also being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all these meanings and more. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sayyidina Muhammad wa alayhi wa alhamdulillahi wa alayhi. If you have any questions, go. Yeah, I mean the etiquettes of dhikr. Dhikr has adab, etiquettes. At its perfect stage. But I'm not saying that you should not do dhikr even if you have no wudu or even if you're in a state of impurity. Janaba. Do dhikr. For women, menstruation, do dhikr of Allah, of course. But dhikr from dhikr varies. Dhikr with presence, dhikr with tahara, purity, dhikr with, you know, in the right place, the right time. There are factors that actually interfere in the dhikr and what makes the dhikr a better experience or more conducive to actual dhikr, meaning what? Not just remember, not just uttering, but remembrance, right? Remember, dhikr means ridding of heedlessness, of ghafla, ridding of ghafla. That's the whole point. What makes you rid yourself from ghafla? That's dhikr. Wajd means intoxication, in a sense. Less than intoxication, really. Sukr is intoxication, being drunk. Wajd is right before sukr. You know that, a buzz. It may be for when you get these flashes or these spiritual breezes as a middle seeker, and Allah opens for you things, puts that sakina, tranquility in your heart or meanings, you might get some wajd. Or, you know, like some of the people, they, you know, they make salah and salam on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That some of them said that I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving my salam back, for example. Yani, let's say in the dream, for example, let's say in this. Because man, whoever sees the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has seen the truth. So therefore, that from wajd, he, from sort of, he gets a buzz out of it, in a sense. No.
When we are doing more performance on mundane tasks, how do we keep ourselves from slipping into ghafla?
The first level must be maintained. So the more you see yourself slipping, the more your first level of dhikr must be sort of maintained, in a sense. You know, that adhkar that brings you back again, and if you think that, you know, you need more, use the things that sort of forcefully inject that meanings of closeness in your heart, such as Allah is with me, Allah is watching me, Allah is observing me, Allah is my witness, Allah is witnessing me, etc., etc. Now, and Allah knows best.
And when you send salam
onto the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what must you keep in mind? That you're sending, you're presenting something to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As you know, hadith is sahih, whenever you send this salam, your salam to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the malaika takes that salam to him and tell him, Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so and so sends this salam to you, or this our salam to you. So make sure you are in a presenting
how do I say that? And you know, a presentable presenting.
So are you witnessing him in your dhikr or?
If you witness him, that's great. Both. Dhikr alone is important, and dhikr in group is also important. The reason is for dhikr in group is important is because the dhikr in group gives you one aspect you don't have when you're alone. Maybe one of the people in the group just repented truly when you were doing istighfar. Maybe you were doing lip service and that person was actually doing real. And because Allah forgave him or her, all of you will be forgiven. Otherwise, you wouldn't be forgiven on your own. That's one. Maybe there's a child, because of that child, Allah forgives everybody. Maybe you don't know. So there are all these things that are aspects. So both are important, inshallah. The adab of a group dhikr is to observe the one who's leading the dhikr, for example, and as to the ishara. For example, we're going through istighfar, so go through the istighfar. You're doing alhamdulillah, so go through alhamdulillah. You're doing la ilaha illallah, go through that. And, you know, as long as things are not inconsistent with the Quran and the Sunnah, be involved in a dhikr with your heart, not just with your tongue, and don't worry about people. Yeah, don't, when you're doing in a dhikr, don't observe other people. Don't worry about other people. Because you're losing your time if you are. The point is that you're busy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the point. You do get credit for lip service, I believe and hope, inshallah, lip service dhikr.
Meaning shaitan is waiting, I mean, you know that, but you're doing it.
The problem is if shaitan sits on the arsh of your heart, and you know, he's allowing you just to do lip service, the battle is tough. But is it better than nothing? Yes. And inshallah, you will get reward, inshallah. So the point from that is to increase, for example, la ilaha illallah, powerful adhkar. So you sort of push shaitan from the arsh or from the throne of your heart, little by little.
When you say in prayer, assalamu alaykum ayyuhan nabi, so what do we have to
like? Assalamu alaykum ayyuhan nabi. In the salah, you have to be with Allah.
We have to be with Allah. So we can't bring the...
In the salah, you have to be with Allah. Have to be with Allah on your side.
Can dhikr lead to deviation?
Can dhikr lead to deviation? Yes. Can dhikr lead you to deviation? In a sense, does dhikr lead, yeah, dhikr may lead you to arrogance. You say, I'm a dhakir. Huh? Shaitan comes to you and tells you, I'm a person of dhikr, you know, what do you think? I do at least 10 times, you know, 1,000 times, 2,000, 3,000 times every day. Astaghfirullah, what do you do? So now that dhikr became a veil instead of actually removing the veil, in that sense. Shaitan not only will approach you when you're doing dhikr, shaitan now will take permanent green card next to you. As long as you're dhikr and dhikr of shaitan by your own, shaitan is leaving you because you're doing his job for him. He doesn't have to be there. He's got other people to worry about. Soon as you leave his dhikr and you go to dhikr of Allah, he leaves everybody else that comes to you. Sits with you, say, now I cannot leave. I need to get you back on the wrong path. Once he gets you back on the wrong path, he leaves. He says, look, now I'm comfortable. Alhamdulillah.
So how do we know into a state where they become aware of their environment. So it's also going to train.
As long as these things are experiences and they don't affect your mental, they don't cause you mental impairment or anything like that, it's okay. If Allah unveils for you things during your dhikr or post dhikr, etc., etc., you gotta treat these things as, if they're good, as good signs and distractors at the same time.
So you can be to yourself.
Number one. Number two, you move on. In other words, you're moving on. What's your goal? The exit sign? You saw exit sign, very nice. If you exit, you've taken the wrong path. You're gonna keep going. It's not exit yet. You have not reached your final destination. وَأَنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَىٰ. The end is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's where your end is. If you exit before, if you're mesmerized by everything before, right? Always there is a rule. Multafitun la yasal. Those who keep turning around will never arrive at their final destination. They're too busy turning around. That's a golden rule. So those who keep window shopping can never get anywhere. Hey, you've been window shopping for a long time. Salam. Don't dance. We can dance out of dhikr, but in dhikr, let's not dance. Let's dance with the souls in dhikr, but not with the bodies. How's that? Now, anything else? Yes. No. That's a weakness. If that happens, that's not a state of kamal, perfection. That's a state of weakness. Anyone who says, I am Allah, or I am part of Allah, or I am the son of Allah, or I am the child of Allah, or Allah is part of me in any way, sense or form, that this person is kafir bila mathnawiyya. Yani kafir without hesitation. Without any hesitation. And the kamal, the perfection, is what Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did and what the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum did. Have we heard that from the Sahaba or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about that? Now, if somebody says that instead of intoxication, that's a state of weakness. Being intoxicated where you have a mental judgment impairment is not a state of strength, but of weakness. All the spiritual flow can come to the Anbiya and nothing. They're there, la ilaha illallah. Like, and the one who is weak gets a little bit and he's out. Now he thinks he's a prophet maybe. Or he says, I am Allah, not only a prophet. At the kafir, if he's aware. If he's unaware, it's sukur. So once he wakes up from sukur, if he remembers, he makes a step. But if he doesn't remember, he's okay. Like, and that's not a state of strength. That's a state of weakness. Absolutely. And therefore the kummal, the kamilin from the awliya radiallahu anhum, were never subjected to that in their final stages. They can handle that. All right, tell them.
What is a good book that you recommend for purification of the heart in English and Arabic?
Al-Qur'an al-Kareem. It's the best book I recommend. Huh?
The book on instructions on how to best go about implementing
the sunnah, authentic prophetic sunnah. I'm being truthful. If I give you anything else, I'm taking you in circles. Break yourself into the book and seek the people of ilm, and they will explain that sometimes some of the dimensions of the book. Now, barakallahu alayk. Now.
When you read the Quran, is it easier to forget like your nafs, like forget the self when you're reflecting on it? Does it make it easier?
The Quran reading is also dimensions. Reading or listening. First, you understand what's being said. Then you interact with what's being said. Then you live with what's being said. Then you lose yourself in what's being said. Right? Because this book is talking to you in one aspect or another. So you gotta move through these levels, that's all. And it doesn't have to be quantity, quality.
You're losing concentration during the dhikr, so can you use some picture like kind of the name of Allah's picture?
You may, that's again a tool for the weak, not a tool for the strong.
So is there anything else to do for removing the whole sense?
It's a mental picture rather than a real picture. Yes. Dhikr in prayer? Prayer is dhikr. Yani salah, you mean? Salah is dhikr.
Can you say dhikr in prayer?
The prayer is supposed to be dhikr. This prayer is among the highest forms of dhikr, obviously. It's specified dhikr. It's beloved dhikr. It's obligatory dhikr. So remember when we talked about the past two khutbas about the Bismillah, the Fatiha, for example. Alhamdulillah. That's sort of, you want to go through some of this motion to be in dhikr rather than just doing lip service or a ritual in the salah. So realize these things as much as you can. Yeah.
Is there any authentic proof when we get in dhikr?
Yes. Fi sahih Muslim.
Hadith
Muawiyah.
Authentic.
Yes. Of course. Sorry. Yes. Anything else?
Some people do dhikr to relieve calamities or ask for something. Is that not a pure form of dhikr?
No, I mean, I don't want to say that, because as long as you make dhikr with niyyah of baking dhikr and you hope that Allah gives you also other things with it, it should be fine. But one should never say, I want to make dhikr to you, Allah, and this so you can give me this. That's not, that lacks etiquette with Allah. But one should never avoid making dua for removing calamities, all of them, and specify them no matter how small. That's important to do, in fact. Yeah. Yes.
And one more, should the focus of the dhikr should be, how you say, in the heart, or is that?
The conscientiousness is your conscience, is the state of your conscious entirely. Your whole, is it present with Allah Ta'ala in the dhikr or not? That's the whole point. That's the litmus test. Yes. Yes. Sorry. It's an innovative way of doing things, and I don't really prefer it in general. The best is to stick to that which came in the book and the sunnah.
Yeah.
So mention your Lord loudly or secretly, both. Yeah, not too high. Because of the hadith, irba'u ala anfusikum, lower your voices. As long as within reason. No. Oh yeah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.